Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you folks this morning. And you know what? I had all these plans of having an intergenerational service this morning, but our young people have been hit with many a cold and a different bug over the last little while. So you folks are just gonna have to be very young at heart today, okay? You promise you're gonna play along with me in the spirit exchange. All so you're shaking their heads. What else is new, right? Folks, first of all, welcome to worship this morning. My name is Reverend Isaac Mundy. I want to let you know that we're going to be sharing in communion this morning. And just a reminder that no matter what background you're from or where you've been or who you love, you are welcome in this place and welcome at Christ's table this morning. And so if you'd like to join with us in communion, you are more than welcome to do so. If you want to sit it out, that's fine too. It's all, either way, we're happy to be sharing in this feast this morning. A reminder too that we'll have several servers up at the front. So we'll have two folks kind of right down here and two folks over there who will be holding bread and a cup with juice in it. And you will be invited to come forward and take a piece of bread and dip that bread in the juice. We will also have two communion servers. So Dawn, can you wave to everybody, Dawn? Rosemary, can you wave? Now, they are married. They do end up going the opposite. I don't notice this now, I feel like. But they do really like each other, and they will be next to each other. So if you'd like to be able to receive communion in the little cups and the bread, they'll be coming around, and you can just signal to them if you'd like them to come over to serve you communion. But everybody else, I'm going to invite, let's see, all the folks in, well, choir's going to come up first. You get first dibs on communion, and then everybody in this area and moving further back will invite you to move around the sanctuary and come and receive communion either here, or if there's somebody already receiving communion there, then you can move to the next station over here. And the whole congregation, I'm going to invite you to receive communion by moving in that circular fashion. If this sounds confusing, if you don't remember how it works, just follow the person in front of you. Lots of pressure on you, Paul, but everybody else, just follow along. We are so excited that construction in the middle auditorium is completed. We are having the health unit that is going to be coming, my right, is it tomorrow that they'll be coming in to sign off for our, I believe it's our final check. And so we're so looking forward to being able to celebrate. And next Sunday, we're going to invite you to come down after the service as we have a dedication of our new kitchen space. And I think there's going to be some awesome refreshments. So this is our last Sunday with snacks being wheeled out on the trolley up to here. Next Sunday, we're going to be heading down. So was somebody about to clap? What was that? Thank you so much to all of the work that folks have been putting into organizing the work, the grant writing, the taking things out, putting things back in, cleaning. It's just been amazing. Our grant construction, for all intents and purposes, is for the most part completed. Our inspector came by, our city's inspector came by, and has asked the contractors to make a few slight changes. We don't have to re-pour concrete, as far as I know, but just a few things with some of the railings. But until that point, until we have the sign-off from our city inspector and just finish a couple of those last little pieces, we'll ask that you refrain from using those side stairs and that side entrance and ramp. But pretty much we're all done. We're just waiting for the last little bits of inspections to take place. Your income tax receipts are at the back of the sanctuary, and so we'd love it if you would be able to pick those up. If they haven't been picked up by Sunday, February 12th, we'll mail them out. But if you want to help save the church some postage, we'd love it if you would be able to pick up your receipts there at the back of the sanctuary. And there are a few sets of offering envelopes that are right back there on that chair. So if you'd like to pick up your offering envelopes, you can do so right over there. Our annual general meeting for our congregation is going to be taking place on March 5th. We are planning on having it available on Zoom again this year. And just a reminder for folks who are submitting reports, that those reports, we're asking that those be in by February 7th, which is this Tuesday. So you've got lots of homework this afternoon, folks, to be working on those reports, and we'll try to get those in by Tuesday. We're very much a great group gathered here this morning, or last week on Wednesday in the middle auditorium and online to be able to share in the gift of the Psalms study group with Reverend David. And even if you weren't there for that first session, you are welcome to join us on February 8th and 15th. The sessions are at 10:30 a.m. And if you can't make it in person, but you might be able to make it via Zoom, please let us know at the church office, or send me an email, or give me a phone call, and I can send you that link for the Zoom session. And I had a lot of good reviews from folks about the first session, so I think that these next two are going to be wonderful as well. Our ad hoc Pride Committee team is going to be, or ad hoc Pride Committee meeting will be taking place on February 8th, so that's Wednesday at 5 p.m. And we're going to be talking about different events and possibilities for the spring and summer. And so we'll invite you to come out for that session. And if you're interested, please join us as we continue to do more planning for the future. I already mentioned our new kitchen dedication on February 12th. So that's next Sunday. Also on Sunday, from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock, the city of Piney West is going to be holding the In Their Shoes fundraising walk. It's also an awareness walk. And so we're going to put together a team. We're going to have people coming to the church, because lots of folks from all across the community are going to be coming to see what the Warming Center is like, to be able to understand a little bit more of the situations of the people are living in, experiencing homelessness in our community. People will also be walking to places like at the Crossroads, Community Partners for Success, which is in the downtown, and then we'll be heading back to Duncan Memorial Gardens, the arena, to be able to have a light lunch. The lunch, I believe, is going to be on as of 2 o'clock, so maybe more of a lupper, it will be, I think a lot of us will be heading back at around 3 o'clock to be able to meet and share in a meal. If you want to be able to make a donation to the church, let us know at the office, or you can go right to the event link that is in the announcements that are sent out each week in our email blast. But if you'd like to be a part of the walking team, you can sign up at the back of the church. I believe that there's a form right behind Shirley. Can you wave at folks? Right behind Shirley, if you want to sign up there. If you feel like you don't want to walk, but you'd like to drive, I heard that Yvonne is going to have a minibus that she's going to be, she might just have her car.
She drives.
but some folks will be driving from site to site as well, so we'll meet up at the Duncan Memorial Gardens. But I'd love to have you on my team of people walking. Even if you aren't able to make a donation, we'd still love it if you could join us, so that we can see some of the different sites in our city and think more about the situation of homelessness in our community. Finally, in terms of Sunday's going to be a busy day, right? Dedication, we've got the church service, we're going to be heading back to some Sunday school sessions as well. We've got the walk, but also remember our deadline of February 12th for our newsletter articles. So if you'd like to have a newsletter article in, please have it in by February 12th. To Diane. I think that those are all of the announcements that I wanted to bring to your attention for this morning. So I'm going to invite you all to rise as you feel able and greet one another. Sign of thanks. Join me in our candlelighting prayer for this morning. In coming to you, God, we trust that the lights will turn on. Your graciousness paves the way.
Your glory steers our passage.
We pray and sing together, listening for your answer.
When we call on God, we hear your voice saying, "Here I am." Amen.
Amen. Wow, that would have been embarrassing. Folks, let's rise if you feel able to sing our opening hymn, which is One Bread, One Body.
Well, here's why. The bottom line of your fastings is profit. You drive your employees much too hard. You fast, but at the same time, you bicker and fight. You fast, but you swing a mean fist. The kind of fasting that you do won't get your prayers off the ground. Do you think this is the kind of fast day I'm after? A day to show off humility? To put on a pious long face and parade around solemnly in black? Do you call that fasting? A fast day that I, God, would like? This is the kind of fast day I'm after. To break the chains of injustice, get rid of exploitation in the workplace, free the oppressed, cancel debts. What I'm interested in seeing you do is sharing your food with the hungry. Sorry, it's hard to do both. Inviting the homeless poor into your homes, putting clothes on the shivering ill-clad, being available to your own families. Do this and the lights will turn on, and your lives will turn around at once. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. Then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and I'll say, here I am. Here ends today's reading.
Thank you, Carol. And friends, I'll invite you to join me in a moment of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So folks, the last week and this week and two more weeks ahead, I'm talking about United Church meals that might just change your life. I'm hoping that they'll help change your life because in some ways they've changed my life. Last week, does anybody remember what we ended up talking about last week, the meal?
Chili.
Tim Horton's chili bowl, good memory, okay, we're there together. Today, I want to do a little bit of a combo in terms of talking about both communion and pizza. I'm sure that most of us, when we think of communion or pizza, we pair the one with the other. And today, too, I wanted to talk because I've had some different pizzas over the years in church. And some have been better than others. Just before I start talking about this, actually, does anybody part of the ownership family of Cortina Pizza in Sudbury, Ontario? No? Okay, good, because it's really bad. hopefully they don't watch. It was at the time. We would always order from them. For this event called the Advent Event at our church in Sudbury. And really, like, you could have put cheese and tomato sauce on the pizza box and would have tasted better than the actual pizza. It was really not very good. Also, I remember sometimes we would try and make mini pizzas at the time. It was kind of getting more popular in the 90s, and we would make them on little English muffins on youth evenings. Those ones weren't always the most amazing. We've since perfected it in our household with the English muffins, but sometimes it wasn't all that great. But one pizza that I remember really enjoying a lot was with this group of young people. I was doing my internship at a congregation called Mount Royal United Church in Montreal, and I did a lot of work with the young people, and we did all kinds of events through the year. This was right before we went on those treetop swinging along zip lines that you can do. And I think maybe I've told you folks before that since all of them weighed like a third of what I weigh, they would always bob along the rope, and then I would get on and just kind of hurdle and hit one of the trees, and it was always a bit intense. Every year, though, they would do a fundraising activity, and this predated me by a number of years. They would do an activity called the 30-Hour Famine, and I'm sure that lots of folks here have done this event in different ways, where you raise money for food relief work through World Vision. You spend 30 hours together. What I really liked about this event was that they always kept it really joyful. This idea of fasting, first of all, was meant to be able to move towards a deeper sense of justice in the world, to be able to help people who were the most hungry. So it wasn't just about our own piety in terms of spending this time not eating. So they raised money ahead of time. Lots of people ended up sponsoring them. And then we had lots of fun through the activity. And I think working with some of the parents of the young people to do the leadership really helped me. Because at that time, I wasn't a parent. And so I didn't really know a lot of the time what exactly I was doing. And you know, sometimes people would come to me and say, oh, I've got a soccer game. I'm going to only be able to do the 28-hour famine. And I think if it had just been left up to me, I would have, at that point, would have been like, nope, you're out. But the parents were more lenient and were stronger on the joy aspect of things. And so we played games and we went out bowling and we were in Montreal, so we would have the Habs game up on the projector screen during the evening and play all kinds of fun games through the night. And usually by the morning, on the Sunday morning, as we rolled into church, we all looked a bit disheveled because we had been doing a lot of, there was no shower in the church. And so you folks know on Sunday mornings, my hair looks kind of bad at the best of times. So you can imagine what it looked like after a sleepover. And we would get into the service and we were all really hungry by that point, but often we would have communion on that Sunday. And I remember tasting the bread, you know, often just a small bit of bread and the grape juice. And it was this feeling of joy. It was this feeling of being in community together. That hunger that we experienced led us to move from fasting to feasting and embracing that joy, that justice, that presence of Christ. And that helped us point forwards. Communion helped to point us forward to the meal that took place afterwards. So we probably could have ordered from the aforementioned Sudbury pizza place, and it would have tasted good, but I always made sure we ordered for Pizza Hut, because that's my favorite, and I love the deep fried crust. Anyways, we don't have to go into all of the details. I think it's so important, though, in this passage that we heard Carol read this morning, that God is not looking, when we talk about fasting, God is not looking for some proof from us of how pious we are, and that our worship lives divorced from justice just doesn't make sense in terms of how we approach life in community and life with God. Can we go back to that passage? We used a different translation this morning, Communion Plus Pizza. This idea of God speaking, this dialogue between people, and we hear what God is saying. What I'm interested in seeing you do is, instead of this whole idea of fasting just to prove how pious you are, what I'm interested in seeing you do is sharing your food with the hungry, inviting the homeless poor into your homes, putting clothing on the shimmering milk cloud, being available to your own families. Do this and the lights will turn on and your lives will turn around at once. Then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help and I'll say, here I am. When we come into worship, we're wanting to meet the God who says, here I am. Sometimes we come into worship and we're coming from different places. We might feel happy about the week that happened. We might feel sad. We might feel content with where we are in the world. Maybe we see something that needs to be changing. But God is inviting us into a place of reimagining the world, our relationship with that world, and being together in this place with joy so that we can move out to the world with a sense of God's love. We can imagine that feast, God's feast, in all kinds of different ways. But I came across, I was looking through some of my resources from the 30-hour famine, and I saw one of the suggestions that they suggested you share of a video clip. And it's I thought I would share it with you. It's from one of my favorite 90s movies. Did anybody ever watch the movie Hook before? A few people? Yeah, the story of Peter Pan grown up, but then trying to go back and get reconnected. And there's a particular feast that I really love this scene. So I'm hoping that this video is going to work, because if not, we're going to have to act it out all together. So let's see how it goes here.
Just click in a second.
So folks, the scene that we just shared, the food fight, you can feel the joy, right? Has anybody here ever had a food fight before? We're too proper as United Church folks, right? Food fights. There's this joy that is there. He's able to deal with maybe some of his adversaries that take place, and then there's this recognition in the midst of that joy and fun that that there's this figure that he's still there, that even though he's grown up, Peter Pan is still grown up, there's still this place inside of him that they can see, the lost boys of the story of Peter Pan. And even if you don't know the story that well, you get a feeling of the joy and the fun that they're having in the midst of the food fight. What I would like you folks to do this morning, I want to take a little pause here in our message, and what I'd like you to do is turn to some of the folks who are near you, and I would like you to do a bit of planning of what your alternate feast is, because this morning we will be sharing in communion, but let's think of all the different kinds of meals that communion could point to, and it can be really an unorthodox meal. We look at the food that's up there in terms of, so I want you to plan out which food, who's coming, and what location. The food, I know that there are lots of people who love avocados here. There's an avocado right there, some ice cream, maybe a pineapple and a spinach smoothie. Think about who would come to the feast. Who would you like to invite that maybe sometimes is on the outside looking in? Who could we invite to a feast to allow them to come to a place of being seen by God or being able to see God and see that one who says, here I am. And then whatever location you want, it could be in our newly renovated kitchen downstairs. It could be over at City Hall or at center field of the Rogers Center. I don't care where you decide that you want your feast to be, but let's plan a little bit of a feast together, and I'd like us to maybe have a little bit of a time to share in terms of who we're inviting and what our feast might look like. So do you feel comfortable figuring this out with some of the people around you, figuring out a feast? Are you up for it? Let's do this, okay? You might have to. Okay, everybody, let's bring it back in. Let's bring it back in. And what I'm going to suggest is, can you share with me what your feast looks like? Who's coming? Where does it take place? Anybody ready to volunteer? Oh, don't be shy, folks. Oh, Shirley, yeah.
We're going to base bar lunch on the first lunch here, March 3rd.
Okay. Yes.
So our lunch is based on that. So we're going to have ham and pineapple, rosemary's cheesy potatoes, some vegetables.
Sweet.
So we're going to prepare food here and then bring it there and serve it there for our wonderful guests.
Perfect. Okay, awesome. Thank you, Shirley. So we're thinking about our first community meal back. That's going to be talking, taking place right at the beginning of March. We've got cheesy potatoes. We've got ham, pineapple. Ham and pineapple go well together, right? We're going to cook it downstairs and then bring it over to the marina and invite the homeless population here in Trenton to be able to share in that meal. Love it. Thank you. Any other ideas? Betty?
So our group enthusiastically embraced the idea of spaghetti.
Spaghetti. Love it.
Lots of garlic bread.
Lots of garlic bread.
Meatballs.
Meatballs, yeah.
And big garlicky Caesar salad.
Garlicky Caesar salad. Might be an issue with breath.
Have it at the shelter at Centennial Park.
Have it at the Centennial Park shelter. Perfect.
Everybody is invited. People walking through the park, people from the church, people from wherever. All invited.
Awesome.
Not sure where we're cooking the spaghetti. Here.
Okay, so cooking the spaghetti at the church, going to Centennial Park, and everybody is welcome. Anybody walking through the park, you folks are invited. This all sounds great. Perfect.
In June.
Okay, yeah, maybe not tomorrow. What about over on this side of the church? Anybody have any ideas? Are you folks willing to volunteer? Go for it, Kathy.
Ray and I decided that we were going to have it at the Rogers Center.
At the Rogers Center? Okay, nice.
At the center, but never on the grass.
Okay, yeah. Ray, you've got homemade wine, is that what you said? Oh, nice one, okay.
We're going to make the ice cream.
Ice cream, okay, perfect. This sounds excellent. And everybody you said who might be walking by the Rogers Center? Perfect, okay. I saw the music team at work. Anybody want to share from Andrew? Yeah, okay, Andrew.
So we're making a homemade pizza, either on
heat
or falafel.
Yes.
And homemade pizzas. Okay, whatever you want on the vegetables. Everybody is invited.
My house. Okay.
Pardon?
It'll be in the summer.
Because we have ample parking, people can come through. And for those who can't, we can have the bus and stuff.
Okay.
The school across the street for parking. We have lots of room. We can set up tables there.
Nice.
We did this once before when
we went on the track. Yeah, I love that. The buses are going to be bringing people in.
That's great.
I like pizza on pita, by the way. Okay, so folks, I'm sure that there were other ideas. I might not go through all of the different ones. It's kind of fun, right, to be able to plan the ways that we can be together. And I think it's so important for us to be able to do that as a people of faith, to be able to understand that Christ invites us to this feast, and then this feast points outwards to other ways of being able to share with one another and also with the wider world. I just want to touch on a few of those key ingredients that I think that can go into those meals that we share together. Maybe go back to the movie Hook just a second here to think about the joy. We want to be able to have those moments of joy, and whether that means that we have cake all over our face or otherwise, we want to be able to share in laughter, to recognize that God is not just this gloomy God that's kind of stuck in the mud. God invites us to that place where we think about the lights turning on again. But we also want to make sure that we look towards the possibilities of justice. We saw that even in the midst of all of that joy, that there was conflict that was there. Maybe somebody who wasn't really that happy that Peter Pan was back. But he's the one, he doesn't seek revenge against the one who is upset with him, but he's able to transform an act of violence into an act where everybody stops and understands something is new is happening. Something is being renewed in the world. This is why we look as a people of faith for justice and make sure that everybody is included at the table. And one other moment. So Jesus doesn't appear, as far as I know, in the movie Hook, But I think it's kind of interesting that it seems like all of the people around the table suddenly recognize Peter Pan in this moment. And I think about at the table that Jesus shared the Last Supper with his disciples, that moment when he breaks the bread, and there is, you can imagine, this deep moment of recognition as all the people around the table see Jesus, both for the man that he was, but also the presence, the incarnation of God. Jesus is the one that helps us unite our justice and our joy, helps us unite our own families, but then also helps us to reach out to others. Each one of us is called to that moment of awe and wonder to be able to share in Christ's life. And that's what we'll be doing in just a few moments together today. So what I'd like to invite you to do before we do that, whatever meal you're going to be sharing later on in the day, whether that's pizza or hot dogs at the Rogers Center, or Ray making us some homemade wine, or spaghetti, or cheesy potatoes and ham and pizza, all of these different things, we want to be able to bless one another, bless the presence of God in our lives. So can we say a prayer together? God, we thank you.
For all the ways
you help us to fast and feast.
Make us your people of joy.
Make us your people of justice.
Make us Christ's people.
Amen. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for sharing in these different ways of feasting together today. And let's take a moment now to reflect together, and as our ministry, our music team leads us in our ministry. May God be with us.
God is here among us.
Let us open our hearts to God.
We open them to God and to one another.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Please be seated. we thank you that across the ages you have always feasted with your ragtag people, with Abraham and Sarah when you promised them a child, with the Israelites on the night before they escaped Egypt, with the promises you gave Isaiah that all peoples would share in a banquet of finest fruits. We speak with all creation, saying, you are holy, God. You are strong. The earth and the galaxies are filled with your goodness, and that goodness is there in the one who comes in your name. We thank you that Jesus chose to eat with the folks who everyone else had pushed aside. He was the life of the garden. He shared meals with tax collectors and criminals. He ate with women who'd been treated unfairly. And he even shared a cup with a man who had had him arrested. On that night, when his friends let him down, Jesus still prayed with them, and he broke a loaf of bread and said to all of them, friends, this is my body broken for you. When you do this, when you share this, remember me. Likewise, later on in the meal, Jesus poured out the fruit of the vine. And shared it with his disciples, saying, take, drink, this is my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. This is the new covenant in my blood. When you drink this, remember me. As a people who remember Christ, as a people who share in his joyful presence, as a people who look forward with a sense of hope in God, we speak these words together. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God, we pray that you pour out your Spirit upon each one of us, that you bless us with that Spirit, and we ask you that you also are present to all those in need in our world, those who we would like to welcome to our feasts, the homeless community here in Trenton, for all those who are moving through extreme illnesses and face the possibility of death, for those who are mourning and who have lost loved ones. We pray too for the people of Ukraine, in the midst of the violence that is taking place even still on this day. God, we ask you to help us and to hold our elected leaders to a sense of accountability so that all those who are pushed to the margins might know your justice, your love, and your joy in this world. God, we pray to you, our Creator, who made each one of us. God, we pray to you as Christ, who is our Redeemer, the one who comes to save us. And we pray to you as our Sustainer, who walks with us on the road always and joins us in our feast. It's with a sense of your deep love that together we pray the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Friends, Jesus Christ, the bread of life, Jesus Christ, the true vine. You are welcome to come forward to Christ's table and join in the feast. I'll invite our communion servers to come forward. Friends, I'll invite you to join me in our prayer after communion. We give thanks that bread broken brings wholeness, that juice poured out replenishes, that time spent with the risen Christ and one another is the fulfillment of justice and grace. Amen. Friends, we are called to share our food with the hungry, to give shelter for those without homes, to offer clothes on the shivering mill cloud, to be present to one another as Christ's family. Through the dedication of our gifts and offerings, let us commit ourselves to God's kingdom of justice. Our closing hymn this morning is one that will probably be fairly new to a number of us. And so Diane and I have been talking this week, and what we're going to invite you to do is join in on the chorus, and I'll sing through the different verses. If by the end you're feeling really confident on the verses, I say belt it out, go for it. But for sure, you're going to help me out on the chorus, right? After the first one, we'll sing through the chorus one time for you at the beginning. The music team is going to be helping us out as well. So once we sing through the chorus once, I'm gonna give you the nod. You're gonna stand up and we're gonna rock out. Okay, promise. All right. Okay.
All come.
bless one another. God, be in your head and in your understanding.
God, be in your eyes and in your looking. God, be in your mouth and in your speaking. God, be in your heart and in your loving. God, be at your end and at your heart.
And friends, as you go out from this place, know that each one of us is called to share in Christ's feast, to share the banquet with all those in need, to share it joyfully, and to recognize Christ in all those whom we meet. Friends, go now.